Hello everybody, we've made it to part four, we got there. If anyone's still trying to find the good in this bloke, I would seriously suggest you look at yourself, because there is nothing good that this bloke did at work, and he probably still went home thinking he did a good day's work. When all we know now is that to call him a post office investigator is ridiculous. I'm glad they've put a short eye in investigator, because he is not an investigator. He did the bare minimum of anything to do with investigative work. He was just rubbish. And also, as well, we know that it was just a running boy for the solicitors, Cartwright King, who likes to put lots of the blame on until he couldn't put all the blame on it, then he started blaming other people. Anyway, part four, let's get going.
Thank you, Mr. Bradshaw. I'm going to move on from the case studies and look at some contemporaneous complaints that were made by some sub-postmasters. This is a letter to yourself that was ultimately exhibited in a county court case of Asfar Saeed. Do you recall?
No, recall the names.
The history of events and chain of activities carried out and conducted by the investigators known as Mr. Steve Bradshaw. He doesn't know the name of the person from Royal Mail. And over the page he says Miss Diane, presumably that's Diane Matthews. Or was there another Diane who you worked with?
It's probably Diane Matthews.
This document is based on unpleasant experience, inappropriate exercise and improper conduct of practice, unbearable attitude, harassment and victimisation, bully faced by Mr. Saeed and the family during the unfair and undue suspension and investigation process. He says, I entered into the house. Mr. Bradshaw, with one of his lady colleague called Diane, was waiting for me. Steve Bradshaw stood up, shook the hands. Mr. Bradshaw showed me his identity, offered for them to be seated. He pulled out some forms from a file he had and asked me to sign. The forms were not ordinary. They were legal forms, consent to search my house. Mr. Bradshaw told me they came to search my house, whether I stashed money, post office paperwork or financial documents. I was astonished and very unhappy and reluctant. Mr. Bradshaw threatened me if I do not consent, they'll call the police who arrest DNA, detain me and ruin my house by digging and lifting floorboards. I was confused, lost and very disappointed. However, consent. In the meantime, Mr. Bradshaw called his third colleague waiting outside in the car. I let them to carry out the search, my house, my car was fully searched. I think that says, in fact, I assist, and the areas where even they didn't want to, after an hour and 15 minutes search, nothing was found. Some financial details of my bank accounts were noted. He says, because the discrepancy would not exist physically, no cash was over or short, so both were left unresolved, transfer into local suspense. I represent the training book. He says, since then, Chesterfield helpline and trainer were notified and involved to clear the discrepancy error, and the process was arranged by the training department. He says, after detailed dialogue and analysis, some documents prepared by Mr. Steve, I think that's a reference to yourself, the discrepancy was found quite unrealistic and absolutely unnatural. He says, during the interview, Mr. Bradshaw stressed, shouted, and tried to put words into my mouth that I stole the money. That was very offensive and unacceptable, but I replied and rejected his attempts to make me take the words and answer no, never.
At this point, I've just got to mention a comment that someone left on one of my previous videos about why did the post office think it was so not unusual, but there was such a large amount of money going missing that would be so traceable. If they were trusting their Horizon system, even despite all its faults, why would they think that there were so many stupid people who were stealing money that was so easily traceable? None of this makes sense. And just as this complaint says, the amount is so vast and unusual, or unnatural, as this person says. It is unnatural, is it? It's like £40,000. I mean, I am not condoning theft at all, but if you are going to steal a large amount of money, you'll want to make sure it is a big enough amount that you could disappear forever. You'd go to a different country, or you would set it up in a different country and get it all ready. But it's all going to be traceable. So you're going to make sure that it's a large amount as quick as possible and get out as quick as possible. You don't take little bits like this. And even it, whether it's £1, £1,000, £10,000 or £100,000, that is not a life-changing amount, is it? You got to be in the several millions. What was the post office thinking? Why is Mr. Bradshaw, Steve Bradshaw, so stupid as well? He had the power to stop any of this. If he actually did his job as an investigator, he likes to keep calling it inquiries now, if you've noticed. He's trying to lessen his part in all this. He likes to call it inquiries now, but no doubt when he goes back to work the next day, because he's still employed by the post office, you know he is going to say, I'm an investigator. I investigated that case. He didn't investigate. Expletive deleted.
As I've already said, repeatedly and reiterate again and again, from the day one of the problem raised, that the discrepancy shortage is a genuine paperwork mistake, remittances, computer error or human error by staff. This is a letter sent in 2009 from a Katie Noblet. I believe she was sub-postmistress in Preston in Lancashire. She says as follows, I'll just read half of this letter. It says, I write to complain about the unprofessional, disgusting behaviour and actions of two of your employees, these being Caroline Richards, a business development manager in Lancashire, and Steve Bradshaw, a post office investigator. The post office I work for is under investigation. I'm now working all hours there. I received a phone call from Steve Bradshaw asking me to make a statement. He wanted my mobile phone number, but I don't use it for work. He asked me if I had any free time, free during working hours, which I replied, no, as I'm working. I asked if giving the statement was something I had to do. He said no, but it could get me in the clear. He phoned again the same day, wanting to know if he could meet me to take a statement. I hadn't decided and wanted to seek legal advice, so I told him I needed to think about it. The following day, Mr. Bradshaw and Ms. Richards came to my place of work and asked if I wanted to make a statement. Without introducing himself, I told them I didn't know because I hadn't had a chance to seek legal advice in under 24 hours when I worked 9 to 5, 6 days a week. I found Steve very confrontational. I told Steve that I wouldn't make a statement without legal representation, and he told me that I wasn't allowed one, which is a complete lie. She says, after a very confrontational 5 minutes, and after Steve didn't get what he wanted, Steve told Caroline to close the post office, which is not his authority to do. As I understand, Steve and Caroline left the store. Now, as I say, these aren't case studies. We haven't looked into these cases at all or in any depth whatsoever. But can you assist us with why it is that your name seems to crop up again and again?
I can't understand, because they're not totally accurate. Certainly Mr. Saeed, he would have been informed. The forms would have been explained to him over the phone, and we would have arranged to go and meet him. The business at the time asked us to ask people for a voluntary search of their home address, and that's what that was for, before an interview. It was always a requirement of three people to do a search, if possible. Now, that was due to an investigator in the past who was shot and killed while undertaking the search. So he was always, where possible, he was always three people.
Simply reflecting on the evidence that we've been through today, from the interviews that we've looked at, looking at these letters, do you think that you might not have been quite as professional as you think?
No, I don't think that. So I will stand. My stance is they're taken out of context.
We have an email from yourself to Gareth Jenkins. And you say, Gareth, can you please see the attached report, and our criminal law team ask you to consider the report and let us have your initial views as to the contents of the report and also your comments on the disclosure. If we scroll up, we have his response. He says, I'm not aware of this case, but when I spoke to Charles McClatkin, who is the, and he's put defence experts and speech marks, for a number of cases. Last week I did mention that he was now involved in a case in Cumbria, so perhaps this is it. We then have an email on the previous page, page 6, from Penny Thomas, and it seems to be a bit of a telling off from Penny Thomas to you. Steve, your request to Gareth Jenkins and his response to you have been copied to me. Please be aware that it is against process for investigators to approach Fujitsu employees direct for assistance with litigation issues. Please direct all your requests via Jane Owen or her team at Salford. Can you assist us? First of all, in terms of Gareth Jenkins, I think you said in your witness statement that you didn't really recall
him. That's one of the, maybe once, twice maximum. There is another email from Penny Thomas who explains why I contacted Gareth Jenkins direct and I was on the request of the criminal law team. Normally, everything would be done via Jane Owen and her team in Salford. This is an exception of why it's done. And there is an email from Penny Thomas that explains that why I've done it.
Yeah, so that's higher up in this chain.
Correct, yeah.
Can you assist us? What was your knowledge of Penny Thomas's role?
Penny Thomas has something to do with the prosecution part of Fujitsu. I never spoke to her a few times.
And what did you understand the problem to be with investigators contacting Mr. Jenkins directly?
I don't know. They put a process in that we were to go via the casework team for any. They were the engagement. The casework team had the engagement with Fujitsu. Probably to stop every investigator bombarding them with what's required.
Do you think that you had enough contact with Fujitsu?
As I said, all contact with Fujitsu was always via the casework team. Anything that was required would go via the casework team.
We have there some comments that Mr. Jenkins made. He says, I've been asked to comment on the expert witness report produced by Charles McLachlan in the case of Catherine McHugh, associated with Brinkfield. Can we all bring onto screen, please, your statement? You say as follows in relation to Gareth Jenkins. You say, I did not know that Gareth Jenkins was considered to be an expert witness. My understanding of an expert witness is a person who has greater knowledge in their particular field than the ordinary person. I may have spoken with him when at the same court, but I do not recall having any discussions with him regarding his role. Had you received any training in relation to the role of an expert?
I can't recall any training to the expert witness. I think Mr. Jenkins was considered by the business to be an expert witness. And as I say, all requests went via the casework team for anything from Fujitsu.
And you said that my understanding of an expert witness is a person who has greater knowledge. Is that still...
I would say that, yeah. Somebody had more knowledge of a particular field than somebody else would be considered an expert.
Mr. Bradshaw, you're still employed by the post office in the security team. You have had a career that spans all of the issues that we have discussed, including the Bates litigation, including the Hamilton appeals. Do you think it's surprising that you don't have a greater understanding of the role of an expert in proceedings?
As I say, Mr. Jenkins has the business had him down as Fujitsu's expert witness.
That's not what I asked. Answer the question.
And I still stick by it. There's a person who knows more in that particular field than the ordinary man.
But do you not think that, given everything that's happened at the post office, you perhaps should familiarise yourself a little bit better with what the role of an expert witness
maybe,
is?
Maybe, but as I say, considering investigation-wise, we haven't done anything for 10 years. I haven't. The last time I will have any investigation through to prosecution is probably sometime between January or July 2014.
Do you think it is unfortunate that at that time you were not aware of what the role involved?
With hindsight, yes, of course it is. You know, there's always a learning process.
In relation to Chris Bramwell's case, if we could look at the final paragraph there. He says, with regard to your statement, which is in effect being treated as an expert report about the Horizon system, the judge has directed that you are to liaise with Mr. Jenner, the author of the defence report, in the usual way between experts to identify the issues of disagreement between you. So you had written a statement in this particular case that was in effect being treated as an expert.
Depends on which statement it is, because I do recall seeing a statement when I said I am not an expert, and I've clarified whatever the statement is. So whatever this statement is, I would need to say it first before sort of seeing it, or they've taken the statement when I explained what we explained earlier about know the workings, the actual hardcore machine, you know, the screen, etc. And what the, if it's working correctly, what happens about transaction from start to finish. Now, if they're taking that as being an expert, I am no expert. I have a working knowledge of Horizon, but I am certainly not an expert.
Do you think it is a little odd, perhaps, that you're being described as being treated as, in effect, an expert, and haven't had any kind of discussion with anybody as to the role of an expert?
Completely, and as I said, in one of the statements where they've got me down as an expert, the beginning of the statement says, I am not an expert.
In terms of your training more generally, can you assist us? Did you have any qualifications, whether it relates to giving expert evidence or if it relates to...
Certainly not for giving expert evidence, no.
And how about carrying out investigations?
I've done the courses and I've done advanced interviewing courses, both with the method search courses with the Thames Valley Police, advanced interviewing by the Metropolitan Police, attended them type of courses over the period of time, and Cartwright King used to have sessions where they go through whatever's there.
We heard at the very beginning about your progression from telegraph officer, television inquiry officer, up to the security team. Do you think that you were provided with sufficient training in qualifications?
I think at the time we went a sort of, you know, for each role, the training has been. Then when I took the role as the security and investigation manager, it was done by Royal Mail Group trainers. And there was a course with pass marks that had to go.
Do you think it was sufficient?
At the time, I had no reason not to think it wasn't sufficient for starting.
And what do you think now?
I can still cover more. I've always said there's always opportunities to learn more. So from there, if that wasn't considered sufficient, maybe it should be a 3-week or a 4-week course with extra added on.
And how many weeks do you think you have been trained on things like disclosure?
As I say, over the period of the time, there's always been the odd day or 2 days, seminars where you've gone through.
Outrageous.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to...
Well, Mr. Blake, you've had a generous 15 minutes, and I think to be fair to those that are following you...
Outrageous to think. He thinks it just needs an extra couple of weeks training or another couple of days seminars. This is outrageous. He's an investigator. He should now be in a position where he... takes just little bits and dribs and drabs of extra little changes that might happen in the law, like what happened in 1996 about disclosure, you know, these sort of things. To still say it should still be learning stuff in the way that he says it and the way that I'm meant to understand it makes it sound as if he's nothing. There cannot be anybody watching this still sympathetic to him. There cannot be. If there is, let me know in the comment section down below. If you are a person out there who thinks that in some way Stephen Bradshaw is right and you feel sorry for him or something. Because you can even go and get qualifications, but it don't mean that you're good at your job. You need experience and everything. And even then, even as the right person, you need to have that good experience and ability. You can't just go to college or a university or go to some... phony baloney training days or weeks at a police course and think that, oh, now that I've got that qualification, I can do it. No.
Mr. Bradshaw, contrary to what you say, you and your department, the security department, were drenched in information that Horizon wasn't working from the very beginning.
Information come through, yes.
And that information came from scores and scores and ultimately hundreds and hundreds of innocent sub-postmasters who were suffering an epidemic of shortfalls.
Yes.
It came from what they told you, but even before that, it came from the thousands of calls they made to the help desk at the National Business Support Centre. And you'd been aware of those calls, wouldn't you?
Not all of them. If we've been with calls away, they'll all depend on which inquiry. You know, what inquiry are we talking about at the moment?
Well, I'm talking about the thousands upon thousands of calls, anguished and perplexed calls, made by sub-postmasters that they could not balance, that the system didn't balance. And your department would obviously have to have been communicating with the MBSC and also the Horizon Help Desk.
They would have been requested from them to see what issues were raised.
You have to communicate with that department, because integral to your duties in the security department was the enforcement of the contractual duties of sub-postmasters, wasn't it?
The call logs would have been accepted, it would have been requested, and there's nothing on the call logs to indicate that there was any issues with Horizon. I would not be communicating with the MBSC team all the time over that. That's their role.
But you would have obtained, surely, as part of your investigations, the call logs.
That's right, and the call logs would have been interrogated to see what issue was there. And a lot of the time you would see call logs where they're showing about how to do with passport, DVLA, disc, etc. Anything that would be relating to Horizon would be further interrogated.
And you say that?
Yes.
You and your department, I suggest, on the contrary, ignored anything that didn't fit the narrative that Horizon was working.
That's your suggestion.
Time and time again, when somebody ended up under your gaze, each solitary, quite often terrified postmaster sitting across an interview desk from you or one of your team would have been told that they were the only ones with a problem. Isn't that right?
No, that's not correct at all. I don't know where that saying the only one is right. As explained earlier, I've never said that to anybody I've interviewed that you're the only one that has this issue. I have never said that, and I will stick to that.
And what I'm going to suggest as well, that you claim that you weren't getting the messaging from the top, that you were, as it were, not getting any information fed to you about unreliability with Horizon from the top. But that isn't right either, is it, Mr. Bradshaw?
That's correct, yeah. I was not aware of any bugs, errors or defects. They'd come down to it, but nobody sort of said anything. Second sight was put in, and the message was that once they put a subject matter expert in, everything will be back to normal. That come from the top. Top down, not bottom up.
By 2012, when you were either giving or prepared to give expert evidence, Mr. Bradshaw, the problems with Horizon were obvious, weren't they?
I've said before, and I will say it again, I am not an expert on the Horizon system.
The lawyers may have written your statement, but you signed it, Mr. Bradshaw, didn't you?
There was one statement about the Horizon issue that is approved from the business.
And you would have been aware, surely, of the pressure building up from the 2009 Computer Weekly article by Rebecca Thompson.
I've seen sight of it, but I didn't follow the Computer Weekly.
That MPs then became involved, inquiring about their sub-postmaster constituents and parliamentary questions, mounting pressure. You would have been aware of all of that by the time you signed that statement.
As I said, that statement came from the business.
And you would have been aware, of course, by that time, and you've already mentioned them, second sight. So, again, Mr. Bradshaw, I ask you to reflect very carefully on this, because I don't want to have to put to you something which I haven't put to any other witness before in this inquiry. But it is obvious that you would have received briefings from those above you. Whether they still exist or not remains to be seen, but you would have received briefings from those above you that it was going to be business as usual. Keep prosecuting. Don't admit anything.
Prosecution stopped, and once the subject matter expert, they were relying on a subject matter expert to come down, and he said once the subject matter expert had done his part, that they expected it to go back to normal. But that never materialised.
Right. Janet Skinner, who sits beside me, whom you interviewed together with your colleague Diane Matthews, she made 116 calls to the NBSC about Horizon. You heard that when Mr. Blake was questioning you today.
I was there on the day. I didn't do any of the pre-work or the post-work that will be done by Ms. Matthews.
The Court of Appeal Criminal Division pronounced, when clearing Mrs. Skinner of any wrongdoing, that there had been an extraordinary failure to investigate the 116 calls she made to the NBSC in a relatively short space of time. You didn't look, did you, Mr. Bradshaw?
I personally didn't, because the inquiry was Miss Matthews. I was there on the day of the interview.
Mrs. Skinner was persuaded by her lawyer to plead guilty to false accounting in return for the theft charges being dropped, and was advised that she wouldn't go to prison if she pleaded to false accounting, but was jailed for 9 months immediate custody. Now, you've heard the catalogue of failures that Mr. Blake put to you. The woman who sits beside me, completely innocent of any wrongdoing, goes to prison for 9 months. Do you have anything to say to her?
As I said, Miss Matthews was the one who dealt with that thing. If Mr. Skinner has been dealt a wrong role, that is completely wrong.
Say something to her! You helped put her in prison!
Diane Matthews, your colleague, didn't think there was a case on theft. She'd have discussed that with you, wouldn't she?
Not necessarily, no.
Oh.
She didn't think that Janet Skinner had stolen anything at all and was of the clear view that there was no evidence of theft. Are you saying that she would not have discussed that with you?
No. She would have reported that to the criminal law team. It was Miss Matthews' inquiry. Everything was all. I had little input into that inquiry. I was
little
there on
input.
The day.
It's gone from no input to little input.
Or post work would have been by the person looking after that inquiry.
So you had nothing to do, for example, with endorsing the contents of the report?
No.
Diane Matthews told the inquiry that she was shocked when Janet Skinner was charged with theft. Were you?
As I say, Miss Matthews is the one that sorted her. I just accept whatever the lawyers that they put that charge in.
Oh, that shrugging! Oh, what a cold, horrible bar steward! Okay, insert your own expletive if you want. I said bar steward. I think you all know what I mean. He's awful, horrible, nasty, horrible person. Oh, I can't enunciate how much I feel about this bloke, because he clearly had something to do with putting her in prison, and he just shrugs. No, it's not my fault. I mean, it was all their fault. It was all... I wasn't the lead investigator. You investigated nothing!
You accept what the lawyers do, do you?
On that particular case, the lawyer, Miss Matthews, looked after that case. I had very little input even afterwards. If I'd known any charges, would have only come when in passing if Matthews had told us.
Juliet McFarlane has been described to this inquiry as a gentle person. Would you agree?
Yes.
So, was she malleable? Were you able to persuade her to do things?
No.
Liar.
Because theft was a wholly unmeritorious charge, wasn't it?
Of course, but as I can say, Miss Matthews dealt with that inquiry.
Did you press Juliet McFarlane, Mr. Bradshaw, to charge theft?
No.
Absolutely, yes, he did. Look at him smile when he says it.
So, this gentle person charges theft contrary to the view of the investigating officer, who has complete responsibility, according to you, for this investigation. That decision on theft has nothing to do with you, you say?
Nothing whatsoever.
What I'm going to suggest, Mr. Bradshaw, is that whoever responsibility it was, theft was a nasty jemmy or crowbar to leverage pleas to false accounting, wasn't it?
That was a suggestion, but again, I can...
But you knew, from a point of view of your long service and your reputation in the security department, that was a legitimate ploy, wasn't it? Charge theft, a bankrupt charge of theft, to squeeze a plea to false accounting. You were aware of that, weren't you?
The lawyers, 9 times out of 10, would have had 2 charges down, theft and false accounting.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Mr. Bradshaw, I represent 156 sub-postmasters and mistresses, and one of whom is Shazia Sadiq, who sits to my left today. This morning, at about 11:25, Mr. Blake took you to the statement of Jacqueline MacDonald given in the mediation case. Do you recall that?
Yes.
And I don't want to turn it up, but essentially, the accusations that Miss MacDonald made against you, she said, Stephen Bradshaw told me I was the only one in this position and that this has never happened before. And she said that after your first visit to her branch, you returned with a lady called Caroline Richards and spoke to Katie Noblet, who was running the branch on their behalf, and you made threats relating to wage deductions and jail time.
But that's incorrect.
Now, I know you've denied this.
Yeah, it's incorrect. For the simple reason, if you let me explain why it's incorrect, is that when we were going for a statement, as normal, because she worked in the branch, the people running the branch with
at least lie quickly.
Consulting Solutions, they're responsible for paying the wages. I have no control to take any wages or deduct any money, or even, and I wouldn't threaten them with any jail.
That's ridiculous. And you absolutely did.
Is, have you been following this inquiry? Did you watch sub postmasters and mistresses and assistants give evidence in the human impact hearings between February and March?
I've seen some of it. I haven't followed it 100%.
Well, Mr. Bradshaw, we act for 156 sub postmasters, and of those, 49 of them have told us that they were told by the post office, by investigators like yourself and other officials, that they were the only one. 49. And 61 of our clients have told us that they were threatened with prosecution. My question to you is that what Mrs. MacDonald says about you is pretty standard practice in relation to how the post office behaved towards
subjects. That's how it sounds like, but when I've done anything, I will... Sorry, can you just go back? Part of it is I've never threatened anybody with prosecution. At the end of any interview, the people being interviewed are informed of the next course of action or next steps.
I don't believe
that. Is that whoever is the lead investigator would do a report, and that would be sent off to the criminal law team or then Cartwright King, and they make any decisions on the next progression of the case.
I can see what you're saying is that the decision to prosecute wasn't necessarily made by an investigator, it was done by the lawyers. But my question to you, and I'll ask it again, was that do you accept that telling postmasters that they are the only one, and we have 49 clients who say that's what they were told, and telling sub-postmasters that they could be prosecuted or go to prison, and we have 61 clients who said that is how they were treated, that was pretty standard, that was pretty typical, wasn't it?
If people in the post office, investigators, have said that, that's completely wrong. I can cut together to say I have never said that to people that you're the only one.
Well, let's look at your behaviour, shall we? It's the statement of Shazia Sadiq, and while we're waiting for that to come up on screen, Miss Sadiq was the sub-postmistress of two branches in Newcastle. She had to pay over £10,000 of shortfalls, which weren't due to be paid, but she did anyway. The post office demanded a further £20,000. She was then a victim of cyber fraud in relation to MoneyGram, and the post office wanted to recover nearly £34,000 from her after an audit. And the cyber fraud had also affected 11 other branches, but she wasn't told about that at the time. Do you recall that case?
I'm not sure about cyber fraud. I do remember a case of MoneyGram fraud, and that was when a bogus engineer, it's probably the best way to describe it, was phoning branches up saying they would come to test the equipment. Could they just input certain amounts? And when they were putting the end, they would say, that hasn't worked, try 20,000, that hasn't worked, try 30,000.
Okay.
That was the case that was dealt with by MoneyGram, because their reasons that once you do it, they will make a payment straight away.
Well, let's go to Ms. Sadiq's statement. So, paragraph 72, it's on the screen. She says, after losing my post office, my children and I were abused in the street. I went to the Wrighton post office, which had been my home. I was near the entry to my home when a group of men began shouting at me and threatening me and calling me a thief. They threw eggs, flour and stones at me and my children. And then at paragraph 76, just scrolling down please, she goes on to say, on the evening of the day the eggs and flour and stone were thrown at me and my children, and I was called a thief, we fled our home with just my children's teddy bears. I have received threatening calls to my mobile phone and emails from Stephen Bradshaw and Brian Trotter. Mr. Bradshaw was a post office security officer and Mr. Trotter was a post office contract manager. And what she says, that, and then she goes on to say, I've received particularly intimidating telephone calls from Stephen Bradshaw, who began calling me before I knew he worked for the post office. He didn't identify himself in his calls, he just made demands of me. Now, what I want to put to you is what you did. You would introduce yourself sometimes. You would say, where has the money gone? Why won't you talk to me? Why won't you meet me at the branch? I've got people who I want to defund the branch. She would find you aggressive and hang up on you, and you would call her back repeatedly, and you called her over 60 times during this period. Is that right? Do you recall that?
I wouldn't say that was completely accurate. The two orders, one took place on the 26th of October, one took place on the 27th of October.
He's suddenly got a really good memory, hasn't he?
I called Mr. Siddiqui on the 4th of November.
He can't remember anything, but now he knows dates and everything.
I'll say who I am and leave my mobile number. I called again on the 8th, because I hadn't received the call back. On the 10th of November, Mr. Siddiqui called me, because I sent him an email later on with the words, our telephone conversation refers, and on that email, as I explained who it was, and it was about arranging a time or place as per what my contract was as a role to do an interview.
That's not true. You hounded her, didn't you?
No, I didn't.
Well, then let's go to the next paragraph, shall we? On the 29th of November 2016 at 13:44, Stephen Bradshaw called me and I refused to speak to him because I didn't know who he was or who he worked for. In that telephone call, which was witnessed by my husband on loudspeaker, he called me a bitch, which I found extremely distressing. That's how you behaved towards my client.
Completely untrue. I do not call anybody that type of name. And she did know who it was because she received an email from me on the 10th of November.
You have shown in your evidence today that you are prepared to be aggressive. You tell people in interviews to get up earlier. Other people have described you as very confrontational. This is the way you behaved, isn't it?
That's not correct, no.
Do you accept you behaved unprofessionally?
No. Nope.
Do you accept that it was part of the culture within the investigation team to intimidate and abuse sub-postmasters?
Nope. A phone call will be made to arrange an interview at a convenient time and date.
Well, let's move to another client, Rita Threlfall. She was the sub-postmistress of the Ford branch in Liverpool from 1998 to 2010. You interviewed her at the Liverpool North Delivery office on the 10th of March 2000.
Right, so work in Royal Mail delivery office.
That's right. And you call that?
I do.
Right, well then perhaps we don't need to go into that document just yet. If we could go to Ms. Threlfall's witness statement, and I'm going to ask you about the circumstances of the interview. So Ms. Threlfall is disabled and she's wheelchair dependent. And she says, in August 2010, I had to go for an interview under caution with the post office fraud investigator, Stephen Bradshaw. The interview took place at a post office sorting office in Liverpool. She goes on to say, at paragraph 48, upon arrival, they left my husband and me in a hallway. We asked for a chair and never received one. I ended up having to sit down on the stairs. This is a disabled lady who uses a wheelchair. She goes on to say, at paragraph 49, the interview room was upstairs. I told them there was no way I could make it up the stairs. In order to make it to the interview room, I was placed in a tiny parcel lift. Do you recall that happening?
I recall going in the lift, and that's untrue. It's a Royal Mail delivery office. The chances of being given a chair would be slim, because as you walk in the delivery office from outside, you have what's known as the caller's office, where members of the public collect the mail. The door facing you is where the sorting office floor is, where all the mail. So you have postmen coming backwards and forwards. During the interview letter, they would have been asked to make themselves known to Royal Mail, because that's who it was. Either Royal Mail would have brought them upstairs, Mr. Knight or myself would have come down to collect Ms. Threlfall, but it wasn't a small, tiny parcel lift. It's an actual lift, designated wheelchair lift, with the thing that takes five people.
Mr. Bradshaw, Rita Threlfall is still shaken by this experience. She's watching today. She suffers, she says in her statement, from crippling anxiety and depression.
I bet they was using that lift to move parcels around, because from his explanation, if it was such a small, tight working area, first of all, they could have still given her somewhere to sit down, but I bet they were using that lift to move parcels around or for storage or something. It was a dedicated disabled lift. Now, I know, and it's wrong that they should use it as such, but I bet they was using it as storage or as a way of moving stock around. And he calls it a designated lift for disabled people. I bet it wasn't used as such at all. And they probably found it an inconvenience. And maybe they tried emptying it first and they didn't get time to do it, or they just didn't bother, and instead just shoved her in instead and made her sit into what would have appeared to be a parcel lift rather than a designated disabled lift. Now, this goes on and on and on.
It arises in large part from the way you treated her. She was too traumatised to give evidence before this inquiry, and Mr. Steen, King's Counsel, who sits to my right, read out these very passages of her evidence on the 23rd of February 2022. The Post Office has not challenged this account. Mr. Bradshaw, this happened. Whether you want to admit it or not, this happened.
It's not a small parcel lift. I can prove it to you now.
Would you still work for the Post Office?
I don't. You?
Would the Post Office put a disabled person in a small parcel lift to attend an interview that was that had been arranged on a floor which they couldn't access today? Is that current practice?
Prior to the interview, I was not made aware of any special requirements, and I can only keep repeating that it is not a small parcel lift. It's wheelchair accessibility. And I can prove it to you now if you wish.
Well, I have to say, and Rita Threlfall would want me to say that you're not telling the truth, are you?
I've got a photograph here that shows the lift.
Oh, that's convenient.
You've had a generous 10 minutes.
I'm sorry.
If I may say so, Mr. Jenkins, and I know these points are of importance to your clients, but I have to be even-handed amongst everyone.
Joan Bailey, who was the sub-postmistress at the Howie branch, do you recall her?
Oh, yes.
You say the merits of the riser system were discussed, and it was explained that in a number of court cases the integrity of the riser system had been questioned. However, nothing had been proven in court by the expert witnesses, and that any of the discrepancies were the result of failings within the Horizon system. You go on to say Miss Bailey could not produce evidence to satiate her claim in relation to the Horizon system. So what you're doing is you're looking at a sub-postmistress who has alleged that the shortfalls that she had were to do with the Horizon system and problems and errors in that system. Your response to her is there have been a number of court cases where that has been rejected. So I'm not going to investigate that, and you can't prove that the system wasn't working. That was your approach, wasn't it? You required the sub-postmistress to prove that the system wasn't working.
That response is what come from the business, as has been previously explained on a number of occasions, yeah, with that statement. That's the business response, what we were told to say.
But also to
assist me to try and find what issues may be with the Horizon system, or would require somebody to say, for example, if you press the F3 key, this happens or that happens, to just blatantly say it's the system, it's very difficult to try and find the starting point to see what's gone wrong.
But you didn't try.
Okay, can we scroll down to the conclusion, please? I'm coming to an end, I'm aware, sir, of my time allocation. You give conclusions and you say, whilst a prima facie case for false accounting could be established against Mrs. Bailey, it may be prudent when all the circumstances are considered and the explanation offered by Miss Bailey at the interview that if all the monies are paid to the Post Office, then consideration may be given to the issue of a caution in this instant. So what you're saying is, effectively, you took into account all the circumstances, the fact that she'd alleged there were problems with the Horizon system, but she couldn't prove it, and you didn't investigate whether there was a problem with Horizon, and you went to offer, and she was offered a caution simply because you thought she'd made an offer to pay the money back.
No, that was put in as an opinion to the lawyers, because there is a prima facie case of false accounting because she covered up a loss. That can't be denied, can it?
Well,
so from
all right, I've got the point from the document. Thank you, Mr. Jenkins.
Thanks,
Mr. Maloney.
Mr. Bradshaw, I act for 73 sub-postmasters, all of whom were prosecuted and convicted, and all of whom have had their convictions overturned. I want to ask you about three people: Kaya Mishak, Della Robinson, who sits next to me, and Mrs. Jacqueline MacDonald, all three people in whose investigation you were involved. Kaya Mishak, first of all. This morning, Mr. Blake asked you about the issue of whether sub-postmasters who came after Mr. Mishak, after he was suspended, experienced problems with the Horizon system. Do you remember?
I did.
The post office position was that they had not.
That's correct.
And it's, Mr. Blake took you to a number of documents, and I'm not going to bring up those documents, but I'll remind you of the substance of the questions. Essentially, ultimately, a notice of additional evidence was served on the 15th of February 2013, and that was referred to in a letter from Mr. Smith to the defence, saying, we enclose in duplicate copies of a notice of additional evidence the statements of Stephen Bradshaw of the 11th of February 2013 and Abdullah Patel of the 13th of February 2013. Mr. Patel was a sub-postmaster who came after Mr. Ishak.
He came to another branch, yes.
Yes. And you said that statements had been taken from both sub-postmasters, and the other statement could have been earlier from a man called Leacott. Do you remember?
So, yeah. I do recall that name, and there was a statement from him.
Oh, yes. Now, the opening note for the case only referred to Mr. Patel as well. Mr. Blake showed you that, didn't he? Now, I'm going to try and assist your memory as to who took over after Mr. Ishak, Mr. Bradshaw. There was a Leacott who featured in the case, and he did make a statement, as you say. But that Leacott, do you remember, was Mr. Ishak's assistant in Birkinshaw Post Office?
That was correct, yes.
Absolutely. He wasn't a subsequent sub-postmaster.
The postmaster was Mr. Patel.
Yes.
He was taken on as the what was known as the interim postmaster. He was there, and I think he put Mr. Leacott as the officer in charge.
Right. But there were two sub-postmasters, you see, Mr. Bradshaw, weren't there? And I don't want to take time on this, but in an email that Mr. Blake showed you from Mr. Smith to you and counsel Mr. King, it said Steve is in the process of taking statements from the two subsequent sub-postmasters who've not experienced any problems with their rising system. You thought that Leacott was a subsequent postmaster. To save time, I'm just going to remind you now, if I may, and try and assist your memory, Mr. Bradshaw, as to subsequent sub-postmasters. The first, there was actually somebody there for a very short time called Mary, whose surname I don't have, I'm afraid. Then Mr. Patel. And then the second sub-postmaster was a Mr. Muhammad Sawar. Did you speak to him, Mr. Bradshaw?
Shortly after that. Well, what date do we have? Because around in 2014.
Between Mr. Ishak's suspension and the trial, Mr. Bradshaw, because that's what we're concerned with. Did you speak to a Muhammad Sawar between Mr. Ishak's suspension
I don't recall speaking to Mr. Sawar. My only recollection is that Mr. Patel was the interim postmaster after when Mr. Ishak stopped being the postmaster. Mr. Patel took over, and Mr. Patel was still in charge, as far as I'm aware, when I went off long-term sick.
Long-term sick for what?
I'd suggest to you that all of the emails suggest that there were two interim sub-postmasters, and it would perhaps be a match of evidence. Mr. Patel first, and then Mr. Sawar. But you did not speak to Mr. Sawar, then?
I don't recall speaking to him, Mr. Sawar.
Thank you very much. Secondly, Miss Della Robinson. You interviewed Della Robinson. She sits next to me here. You were with Mr. Andrew Wise, and you took the lead. Do you remember it?
I remember Mrs. Robinson. I'm sure that that inquiry, I did interview Mrs. Robinson. I'm sure the person I interviewed Mrs. Robinson with was a Michael Stanway, and a search was conducted by Mr. Wise and Mr. Ryan with Mr. Robinson. They went back to Mrs. Robinson's own address.
And Mr. Ryan sits next to Miss Robinson now. Do you remember him?
From
these events, that's Mr. Ryan.
No.
That's her partner, Mr. Ryan.
The Ryan I got mixed up. It's Kevin Ryan, the security manager. He went back with Mr. Wise to conduct the search at the home address.
In any event, it was at a Royal Mail office in Salford that you interviewed Mrs. Robinson.
It was a post office. It was Salford.
In Salford.
It was called, yeah.
Post office. And when you interviewed her, in Hamilton and others, the Court of Appeal said the following about the interview. In her interview on the caution, Mrs. Robinson said that the losses had started about 2 years before. She stated that she and her partner initially made good the losses from their own funds, but as the losses accumulated, this became unsustainable. From around August or September 2010, she instead declared the amounts on the mutilated, i.e. unusable, cash line of the accounts. In her defence statement, she said that any errors or deficiencies were as a result of her difficulties in using Horizon. Now, I just want to ask you one thing about events after the interview, please, Mr. Bradshaw. After the interview, you spoke to Miss Robinson and her partner Michael within that building. In a canteen, they may assist you, where there was nobody else around, but you were sympathetic to Miss Robinson, and you said to her and Michael, her partner, off the record, we know you haven't taken the money, but worst case scenario is that you'll be prosecuted.
No, I wouldn't say anything like that, because it's not my decision.
Don't believe that.
And finally, Mrs. Jacqueline MacDonald, and I'd like to take you to your self-appraisal form, one document only to take you to, Mr. Bradshaw. It reads as follows. On the 5th of July 2010, at the court case for, and the reference is given, I challenged their reasoning for accepting only a guilty plea for false accounting and not one for theft. So this refers back to the same case that Mr. Blake was asking you about this morning. I explained the reasons for continuing with a trial for theft. The integrity of the Horizon system was in question, and that problems would occur for future cases. The defendant denied theft, and the money was missing due to the Horizon system. And then this, and if this was accepted, then this argument would give credence to the current campaign by former sub-postmasters. Now, you were very explicit there, Mr. Bradshaw, about your motives in seeking to ensure that no credence was given to the postmasters' campaign, weren't you?
No, that, as I said, and I explained earlier, that's a
flamboyant way of explaining what had gone on with
them. Of course, yes.
Sorry. It was a flamboyant way of explaining what had gone on the day.
Yeah.
Yeah. It can't be, can it? Because that is a motivation. It's not a fact. In fact, it's clear from the document that ensuring that no credence was given to the former sub-postmasters campaign was something you were proud of, wasn't it, Mr.
No, Bradshaw? It wasn't. As I said, it's a flowering way of putting your one-to-one type notes. Everybody gets PDRs in these days, and I've done for a number of years.
And Jacqueline MacDonald, a mother of no previous convictions, was sentenced to 18 months imprisonment, aged 47, after having no option but to plead guilty to theft, after her offer to plead guilty to false accounting was refused on, essentially, the decision of you, Mr. Bradshaw. You know that, don't you?
Mrs. MacDonald pleaded guilty to false accounting. And then at a later court, they pleaded guilty to theft.
Yeah. She wanted to plead guilty to false accounting. You persuaded them not to accept that plea.
She pleaded guilty to theft.
Yeah.
She pleaded guilty to false accounting first.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Maloney.
And that is the end of part four. Thank you for making it through, everybody. Can we just all agree that we know exactly, really, don't we, that he would have absolutely been a bully in his interviews, his interrogations, because there were hardly investigations, was they? And you can, and from to say, oh, I can't say that because I had no power over that. He would have done whatever it took to make sure that he got his top bonus. If they were on a target between 1 and 4, like we had in either part one or part two of these videos, absolutely, he's going to say whatever it takes to get the top bonus for his top marks on his targets that he's meant to give. Because his boss doesn't know if he's a foot or horseback, as Judge Judy says. He's ridiculous to say that. And at the end here, we've just got the explanation that the photograph that Bradshaw wants to submit as evidence first has to be shown to the victim, and then it has to be proven if it's the actually... a legitimate photograph of it as it was at the time, and it's very unlikely it's going to be submitted as evidence, pretty much. But that's it, everyone. Thank you for watching. Are you as angry as I am with Stephen Bradshaw? He's not an investigator.